My next two guests know all too well the dangers of covering the war in Ukraine. On February 28th, they were a part of a team from Sky News, traveling, trying to drive back to Kyiv when the car was ambushed. There were minutes and minutes of bullets rattling the vehicle. Stuart Ramsay, Sky News chief correspondent, was wounded. Dominique Van Herrden, his senior producer, was with him trying to get help. So they sat down with me a month later, now that Ramsay's recovered, he's gone through a surgery and he's on the mend. They sat down with me to share the story, and I want to know, tell you how we set this up. We decided just to take me out of it. We're not going to show my questions. We just want to hear them in their own words recount what happened and how they survived that day.
It was the first day after a two-day curfew that had been in place in the capital. We had just received new accreditation from the Ukrainian armed forces to go and cover, you know, Kyiv and the outskirts and that sort of whole region. And so we were aiming to go out. We were planning to go to Bucha, a town, you know, 20, 25 miles from the city center. So we set out that day knowing we'd have to navigate loads of Ukrainian checkpoints, and that took hours and hours. And bear in mind, we were going somewhere that should take 30 or 40 minutes maximum on a normal day's drive. It got to around, must have been around 3:30, 3:45 p.m. And we started to look at our watches, and we still weren't in Bucha. That's how long it was taking us. And we could sense that the fighting was starting to increase. And although we were in Ukrainian territory and we were behind Ukrainian lines, we felt that the intensity of the fighting was somehow going up a tick. And we started to feel a bit uncomfortable and made the decision, and this is the irony of it, we made the decision to go back to the city center for safety reasons before it started to get dark.
Dominique makes a very important point here. The battle space was changing absolutely constantly. So the roads that we had traveled on suddenly weren't safe. They had been very safe. There was fighting taking place in three locations, which we found ourselves almost surrounded by. So we didn't have many options. And we had to go down this road, which did not look great, but it seemed to be the best, if not only, option we had at that stage. And then, of course, the rounds started coming in, and it was absolutely relentless. So we started shouting that we were press, etc., but in a stop in the fighting. And then the shooting then increased. In fact, definitely increased. You can hear it in the tape. So it's almost as if they decided, right, we really are going to finish this lot off. And I have to say, being in the back of the car, I was just watching the windscreen disappear, put holes appear in the roof.
It did feel like being in a washing machine with bullets. Of course, the car wasn't turning, but what I mean by that is the bullets were everywhere. And although the camera only, bear in mind, the camera is showing one angle. It's showing the angle from the front of the car where Richie is huddled in the footwell of the front passenger seat. I'm huddled in the footwell of the back passenger seat. And as Stuart says, he's sort of, you know, just taking as much cover as he can on the back of the seat, but the bullets are everywhere. I mean, they're just flying, and it did feel like what I would imagine would be, you know, to be sort of going round and round in a washing machine with things just pinging everywhere. It was impossible to, I don't even know how I wasn't hit, and it was impossible to think that you weren't going to be shot. It was almost like a guarantee.
I was absolutely convinced I was going to die. I didn't think there was any chance the amount of rounds that were coming into that car are going to continue to miss. They kept hitting things. You kept seeing sparks flying off, tracers going. And what really marked it out from other ambushes I've been in the past, and I have been shot up many, many times in cars, many of us who do this sort of job have been. What was different is that this was absolutely zeroed on us. They weren't missing. They were smashing the car up bit by bit, which is quite unusual. So I thought, this is it. And will it hurt? And that's when I got hit. And as I say, I was lucky. It didn't hurt as much as I thought, but I'm sure that's the adrenaline, of course, which is a remarkable thing. I pretty much dropped sort of 20 or 30 feet, probably onto my head, probably knocked myself out, we don't really know. And then Richie joined us shortly, a little time later.
I mean, Stuart points out that he didn't quite feel very, you know, he felt a little bit out of it, mainly because he felt when he fell down the embankment, he got a bit of concussion. And so in this moment, obviously, my first thought is, how badly injured is he? You know, how bad is that bullet wound? You know, we know there's a clear entry wound through the top of his leg. It's come out through his lower back. What does that wound look like? You know, what is now the risk factor? Are we more in danger here, being here in this spot? Do we need to find cover first before we check Stuart and that kind of thing? And, you know, as Martin Vowles, a producer who works with us, who was also there, said, well, it was really a matter of weighing up, okay, he's walking, he's talking, he's breathing. Our first priority is to get to safety. Our second priority is to check that injury. And I think that Stuart was remarkably calm, remarkably held together, considering he had just been shot and considering we'd all just gone through this horrific experience. And as he said, it was showing no signs of stopping.
And of course, although we found cover, as often the case in these scenarios, the initial incident is horrendous, but you survive it. And then it just gets worse and worse, because now there's a huge fight taking outside. We're hiding in a garage, ostensibly. No idea what's going on. And no idea if anyone's going to be able to even come and rescue us. And are we now actually the front line? And I think for some hours, effectively, we were. And we were stuck. And there were very few options available to us but to basically hunker down and hope somebody would come.
We were in the garage for up to 4 hours, 3 to 4 hours. I couldn't tell you the exact time we were extracted, but when we got into the garage, it was still light. By the time we were out, it was dark. It was a good 3-4 hours. I would say, and of course, Stuart can correct me if he thinks differently, but I would say the fighting outside was at least half the time, that we were in the garage. And it was intense. We, in many ways, being in the car, we felt like we could do something for ourselves, which was get out. In the warehouse, we were very much sitting ducks, and it felt completely out of our hands. And I think that was the scariest bit. And for me, the most terrifying bit was being in that garage, not really knowing what might happen next. And with those firefights continuous going on outside, and then of course your mind starts sort of going to all sorts of places that you don't want it to go. Like Stuart said, we've just survived round one. Are we gonna make it through round two? And I really, really actually started to feel, when I had those moments to think, that's when I started to feel a little upset by the whole thing, a little bit afraid, but also knowing that we had to stay on the phone with our colleagues who were talking to everybody they knew in the Ukrainian government and police forces and secret service and you name it, you know, trying to get us out.
We had been there, as Dominique said, for some hours. We had a message back. I think it was a call that Dominique took saying the police will do their best to come and get you tomorrow. It was cold, really now suffering from lack of water. So we decided to go to a sort of administrative area within the garage, sort of upstairs. Suddenly, and I was talking to Richie about this, all we could hear were the sound of boots clumbering up these stairs and got clearly weapons banging against the metal of the building. And Richie said, this is it. They have come and we're finished. And then we heard these beautiful words, we're Ukrainian police, hurry.
The Secret Service had actually got in touch of Ukraine, had got in touch directly with the governor's office of that region and the police force and said, you have to go and get these journalists tonight. You just have to.
So it is absolutely miraculous. And you know, we're very fortunate. I think the real point to remember here is that the reason why we've shown this story was because it's happening to ordinary people all the time. There's nothing exceptional in the attack upon us. What's exceptional is that Richie Mokra, our cameraman, filmed it all.